Hello, I'm Denise Hill. I love sharing stories of my experiences with celebrities, politicians, some of your favorite musicians and artists. But most importantly, I love sharing the stories of everyday people. Their lives serve as opportunities to inspire, empower, and educate. It is my honor to share the stories of those who fought the fight against breast cancer and won. The So Alive Project is all about sharing the stories of survivors and caregivers. Whether you are in the fight, a survivor yourself, supporting someone who is in the fight, or just want to be informed, my hope is that this story will bless you. Please make sure you subscribe to this page or set your notifications on all social media so you don't miss one. I am at The Denise Hill. One of these stories just might change your life. I'm Denise Hill, and this is the So Alive Project. I'm here with Ms. Shonda Sabari. How are you?
Fine. How are you?
I'm fabulous. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for your willingness to be transparent and share your story so that others can be educated, inspired, and encouraged.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate any opportunity. You know, I'm blessed to get to be able to share my testimony with hopes of being an inspiration to others. So I really appreciate you.
Oh, absolutely. No problem. I mean, the work that you're already doing, this is just a drop in the bucket. But I think it's important to share everyone's story. And we'll talk about your advocacy work at the end. But let's start with the beginning. You know, how did you become diagnosed with breast cancer?
Well, 8 years ago, I like to say I scared the hell out of cancer, so it took my breath and left. I didn't have any symptoms. Thank you. I didn't have any symptoms, didn't have any signs, anything to suggest breast cancer. I was getting dressed one day, getting ready to go to the Dollar Tree, and something just said, you need to get a mammogram. And the best way I can describe it is, you know how sometimes when you're out and about and you're riding along in your car and you may forget to stop by the supermarket to get something, and then something tells you, you know, oh, I got to go to the grocery store.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the best way I can describe it. But because I believe in God, I know that something was the Holy Spirit, especially how everything unfolded. I know, you know, that it was God. I didn't hear any voices, didn't see any shadows. It was just something just says you need to get a mammogram. And thankfully, that next day, I was already scheduled to go to my gynecologist for my regular annual exam. And then I told her about it. And she said, well, did you examine yourself? And I said, yes, ma'am. And so she checked my breast, and she didn't feel any lumps. And so she put me in for a mammogram. That next week, I received a letter in the mail, and they said that they saw calcifications and changes in tissue, and that I had some fibrocystic changes going on in my breast. And they said, oh, everything's probably fine. We'll bring you back in for a diagnostic mammogram, because that first mammogram, you know, was a screening mammogram. And they normally don't do mammograms at 36. But again, because I know God is all in my journey, I know it was because of grace, mercy, and favor that I was able, you know, to get that mammogram, you know, without any issues. And so, you know, they did the diagnostic mammogram. And I remember the radiologist saying to me, he says, you know, darling, I can't look at you and tell you that you don't have breast cancer. He says, I'm going to have to do a biopsy. And so they brought me back in and they did the biopsy. And I was diagnosed. I had two types of cancer in my right breast, ductal carcinoma in situ and lobular carcinoma in situ. And it was all stage zero in my right breast. In my left breast, it was just the DCIS, but I had two stages. I had stage zero and stage 1A.
Wait, okay. Okay. There's a lot to unpack there. I know there's a lot more to this, but I don't want to get too far away that we can't get the education out of this or it gets buried in. So it's a couple things. The first thing that hit me is they notified you by mail?
Yeah, which is normal that you... you know, you can get a letter in the mail, you can get a phone call. It just depends on how, you know, your physician decides to contact you. They didn't notify me by mail that I had breast cancer. They notified me by mail that I needed to come back for that second mammogram. So normally when you go for a mammogram, the first mammogram is a screening mammogram. If they ever tell you to come back, then they do a diagnostic mammogram. And so that was the reason that I got the letter in the mail saying that I needed to go back.
Wow. Okay. That's a very huge piece of education that I know most people didn't understand, because I know I didn't understand that. And I'm a regular person who does not check her mail. Now I know that that's important to do, especially if you're waiting for some results. But the next hugely important thing you mentioned is that there were two stages. I didn't know that was possible.
Yeah, I didn't either. I wasn't educated on breast cancer and didn't know, but it's possible.
Was it two separate tumors or within the same tissue? How does that work?
No, so there was one area of my breast, the 9 o'clock. So just imagine the clock. You know, you have your 9 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and 12 o'clock. So the 9 o'clock was the stage zero. The 3 o'clock was the stage 1A.
Gotcha. Okay. So you get this diagnosis, then what?
I thought it was funny at first because I was like, you know, this can't be for real because I never really even get a cold. Like, I never really have any health issues. And so I'm just like, this can't really be happening for real. And then when I realized that, you know, because they called me back with the actual results telling me that I had breast cancer, the nurse started talking. I'm just like, this is really for real. And so I cried. But then I prayed, my husband, our children. And, you know, and I was raised by my grandparents, and my grandmother always taught me that Jesus wept, but on the third day he rose. So whenever you're going through something in life, remember 3 days. You know, you can't get in a dark place and stay in a dark place, because that's not going to solve your problem. That's not going to help me moping and being depressed and being sad. That wasn't going to help get the cancer out of me. You know, I had to get over the initial shock and do what I had to do so that I can figure out a way to beat the cancer.
What was your support system like at this time?
Very strong. My husband, our kids, some of my family members, people from the community, some of my sorority sisters. So it was very strong, but the strongest was my faith in God.
So how do we go to being breastless? Can you talk about the treatment process for me?
Well, because early detection is so very important, and it was caught early, I didn't have to do chemo or radiation. I had to take a pill for 5 years, and I did that. And so that was my treatment plan. It was my decision to have both breasts removed. Even though I had cancer in both breasts, my doctor didn't have to remove both breasts. Now, she had to remove my left breast because the area that was a 1A, it was near a blood vessel. So she had to remove that breast. She didn't have to remove the right breast, but I told her, you know, that I wanted her to remove both breasts. And you know, my breasts, they were small anyway. They were like a cup. And
you know, you say it like that. Now there's space in the world for all of us.
I call them little chicken gizzards. But, you know, for me, the most important thing was getting the cancer out of me, not getting more breasts. That wasn't something I needed to do to live. I needed to get the cancer out of me to live and to grow old with my husband and my children and to raise them. Not get more breath. So my focus was, you know, what I needed to do and what I had to do to survive. And the time for healing, when you go through reconstruction, the risk of infection, you know, I just didn't want to go through all of that. I just wanted them to get the cancer out of me, chop the little breath off, and let me just live my life.
That's a unique type of courage and a unique type of advocacy in collecting these stories. I've heard women say, well, just do them both and get it over with. And doctors have said, no, there's no reason to, and refused. So that's a unique type of advocacy. Can you talk about that strength?
Yeah, you know, I have a really good rapport with my medical team. And I often tell people, you know, it's like my grandma used to always tell me with a relationship. You know, people say, oh, well, my man did this and my man didn't do that. And my grandma used to always tell me, can't nobody do no more than you allow them to do. So it's the same thing with my medical team. You know, we're a team. They trying to get paid. I'm trying to get healed.
Hey, hey.
You know? So we talk. We got to talk and we got to work it out. And, you know, thankfully, because I know how to talk to them. And see, that's the problem. Sometimes people, they may not necessarily know how to talk. And it's not always about using medical terminology that we don't necessarily understand. You know, my grandma used to always tell me, you know, it's the way you talk to people. And you don't necessarily have to have the highest of degrees to be able to talk to people, but a kind heart and a sweet spirit, you know, will get you a long way. And so, you know, because I was able to communicate effectively, you know, with my doctors, you know, I didn't have any issues. She didn't try to steer me in one way or the other. You know, she was very supportive. She told me what my options were, and just left that basically, you know, up to me. And I prayed about it. I thought about it. Talked to my husband, talked to my kids, and boom, you know, it was done.
Now, you sound like a very strong woman. And of course, you've gone through something that I'm sure have made you even stronger than you was prior to this. But even the strongest person has those moments where it's like, you know, I don't know if I can actually do this. It's a bit dark here. Can you talk to us about how you got through those?
To be honest with myself, I don't personally have those type of moments with myself. When it comes to my kids, that's when I sometimes sit and wonder, like, wow, you know, like right now, my son's a senior, my daughter's a junior, and I'm just like, you know, they are my everything. You know, what are they going to do without me when they go away to college? How are they going to make it? But as far as me, myself, you know, breast cancer didn't change me emotionally or mentally, but having had breast cancer changed me physically only in that my breasts were, you know, removed. So I am the same person that I was before the breast cancer. God changed me in that my spiritual connection with Him is deeper and more meaningful to me. And I've always been a God-fearing person, but I get down on my knees more now. I live like tomorrow just may not come, whereas before, you know, it would be, I'm going to do what I want to do because I know that tomorrow this is going to happen for sure. But at this point in my life, I try to do the best that I can in the day that I'm currently in, because I do know that when I go to bed, I may wake up or I may not wake up, but I don't worry about the what if I don't. You know, I worry about how can I be a blessing to my kids and my husband and the people that, you know, I love and I care about. And all these other women and men that are going through not just cancer, but just need a dose of inspiration.
Well, you're definitely being a dose of inspiration right now by sharing your story. I definitely appreciate it. Can you offer some insight in how your conversations with your children have changed, especially your daughter?
My focus now is to, with so much going on now in the world, craziness, is to try to make sure that my kids understand and comprehend that they are in charge of the decisions that they make. And in everything that they do, they need to pray. And they don't always do that, just like I don't always do it. But I always tell them, you have to focus on God. You know, you have to pray throughout the day. So my conversations with them now are more spiritually centered, because I want to make sure that they have the foundation that they need so that when they do get away from home, you know, that they won't depart from the wisdom that I'm hopefully instilling in them and my husband as well.
Can you talk for those who are in relationships about how you were able to keep your marriage strong during this challenging process and afterward?
You know, I often tell people there's a difference between being confident and being cocky. I've always been confident. And, you know, I had a conversation with my husband the day before we had to meet with the doctor to let her know what I wanted to do in regards to reconstruction or no reconstruction. And I said to him, I said, you know, you told me that whatever decision I made, that, you know, you would be there for me and that you would support me. And I said, but I just got to tell you something. If you feel like you need breath to survive, you know, we can end this marriage, because the cancer didn't affect my self-esteem, and I'll be damned if I'm going to let you affect it.
Well, all right.
And so, you know, and he was upset. He was like, if you don't get out of my face. And so, you know, and so to me, I felt like either way, I was going to be the same person. I was going to be missing two breaths, but you know, I got a little sexy little behind, so I got a little space to let you know. So, and the dudes be looking still, and my husband be tripping too. So I knew either way, you know, and not just for the physical, but I know me as a person. And you know, even now, you know, sometimes, you know, he's human, he's a man. You know, and so it would be crazy of me to think that he don't look at other women. You know, sometimes we'll be out and about, and, you know, maybe a fly sister walk by, and I'll be like, she looking good, don't she, boo? And he'll say, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm like, yeah, right. And so, you know, and she, the breath might be sitting up looking right in sight. You know, but that's good. But I'm confident because I feel like, hey, if somebody else can win him over, he was never mine anyway. That means God got somebody better for me. But I'm not about to sit here and drive myself crazy worrying about the next woman with breath, and I don't have breath.
Listen, we're going to have to make sure you come back for the relationship conversations. Because that's good stuff, breast cancer survival or otherwise. I love, love, love it. The conversations with your daughter around her health. Have you done any genetic testing or anything?
We will start to do. She'll be 16 tomorrow, thank God. We've discussed that, and she will start at the age of 16 doing her genetic testing. But we, you know, she knows everything that she's supposed to do, and I'm glad that you asked me that because I talked to her, but I need to make sure she writes this stuff down. So God forbid if something should happen to me. But I think she gets it though, because she and my son, they go and they, you know, advocate with me, so they kind of know. You know, they go with me to my appointments. And we talk, and I encourage them to talk to their doctors. And if something's going on, you know, I encourage them to reach out to their doctors because, you know, it's important that they be able to connect with them. So they have access to emailing their doctors just like I do. So
wonderful, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. I want to wrap it up with just two questions. One, what's the single best piece of advice you can give to those who are battling breast cancer right now? And what is the single biggest piece of advice you can give to women in general?
Let your faith be stronger than your fear. When you say to God, you promised me that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. That word promise is so strong. It ignites something between you and God, and it makes him happy. It just stirs up something inside of him that I found because of how he blesses me. And so, you know, my advice would be to let your faith be stronger than your fear. And I say it, but sometimes, you know, with me, especially, you know, when it comes to my kids, you know, I'm just like, oh, gosh, you know, they're going to be okay. They're going to go to this place without me. They're going to be okay. But you have to learn to do it, because when we show God that we trust him, he's able to do what he needs to do for us. But if we pray and we don't let it go and we try to work it out ourselves, it's not going to work out right. And that's not being fair to God. And he deserves better than that, because after all, he is the only one that can truly answer our prayer. So that would be my advice to men, women, and children.
I appreciate you so much for that. Thank you so much for also being transparent and sharing your story. Very inspirational, very empowering, and most importantly, very educational, because this can be an overwhelming process, I'm sure. And it just helps to know that somebody else who's gone through it is willing to share some insight so that you don't have to feel like you're starting from scratch. Thank you.
You're welcome. And thanks again for having me. I appreciate it. And thank you for all of the other survivors that you've given the opportunity to share their testimonies. And I know that they'll be a blessing, because we all have, you know, separate journeys or different journeys. And so, you know, we all can be a blessing. Nobody's story is better than the other person's. Everybody has something to offer. So thank you, not just for me, but also for all the others that you're given a chance to share what God has done and is doing for them.
My pleasure. My hope is that this story has helped to educate you, empower you, and encourage you. We offer all the love and support we can for those who are in the darkest of moments. And we celebrate that we're so alive for those who have been victorious and survived the great challenge they call breast cancer. Most importantly, I honor the legacies of those who are at rest from the fight. I appreciate each and every person for their willingness to share their story, and I look forward to bringing you more. Make sure to follow me on social media. I am the Denise Hill. You stay blessed.